Yo. what is good? What is good? Only 10:32. Where do you live? Imagine not living on the west coast of the United States. It's crazy. Why doesn't everyone just live where I live? Then these times are great. Doesn't make sense. Like, why wouldn't it just, it's so weird that you would not, Atrioc, I have successfully binged the entirety of your YouTube, so now I'm forced to watch your stream. Thank you for the 1 month, Kyle K. yeah, I don't know, man. It's daily uploads. You're on a crazy pace. You're on an insane pace. Poor Bad, thank you for the prime. Robbie Smith, what's up, boys? What's going on? How's it going? Happy targeting Tuesday. Happy Tuesday. Monday on a Tuesday. Don't call yourself Tarkers. You're not Tarkers. It doesn't make any sense. You're not Tarkers. Yeah, we're going to be doing a targeting Tuesday today. I got a pretty cool, interesting topic. We got to congratulate my dog, Mr. Wig, on getting $4 billion. Or, you know, then really hit some financial goals. Congratulate him on that. And what else do we have to do today? I have some stuff I had to do. I had a Marketing Monday. I had some topics. I had to give you $100. I don't remember that being on my list. I don't remember. Marby's and the winner gets your stock portfolio. You want me to bankrupt myself on a Marby's? All right, I'll give it all up but the Neo stock. You know I hold. You know I'm diamond hands on Neo. I'll put the Alibaba stock on Marby's. I'll put the Nvidia stock on Marby's. I'll put the Amazon stock, the Sony stock, the Lululemon stock, the Twitter stock. That's on Marby's. But if you're going to come after my Neo stock, bro, you have to pry them. You have to find out some machine that can cut through diamond because my hands won't let go. Wow, new headphones. You noticed? Yeah, my old ones were really bad. And the best thing about these headphones, the reason I bought these specifically like this is so that no one can tell when the right one is in the left ear. Either way, you're not going to be able to know. So you're not going to always be fucking coming in chat going, Omega lol. Wrong ear, idiot. Hey, Truck, hope the Big N isn't working too hard. They kind of are this month, but it's for a good reason. We got a lot going on. Busy month, though, for sure. I did manage to complete this Marketing Monday, though, so I'm excited. Jared, thank you for the 5 gifties. Ian Hamilton, thank you for the 9 months. Holy shit, it has been 9 months, indeed. King Fat Willie, thank you for the prime. I'm so glad that your name is King Fat Willie. What crunch? What crunch are you talking about? Oh. Yeah, I mean, I can't be crunching that hard, right? I'm still fucking streaming. yo, I'm 20 and I learned how to blow a balloon today. Thought you'd want to know, Big A. You thought correctly. I'm fascinated. That's awesome. Congrats. Did you learn how to tie it, though? Actually, I retract my statement. Everyone can blow a balloon. You just go, and it fills up. The hard part is being able to tie it. If you can't tie it, you just have, it's not even really a, only real ones can tie it. Are we doing League tomorrow? I'm not sure. I think I may cancel League tomorrow. Unless we do like in-houses or something, because I am going for the world record starting tomorrow. My bitch ass lungs disagree. Smoking that reefer? Smoking that dank? I'm going for the Hitman world record tomorrow. Yeah, I guess what I'm going to do. Hey, Trick, I had a business guy follow me on Twitter today. He's verified and I have 8 followers. Any idea why? No. You haven't given me any fucking detail. I don't know. I don't care. Why the fuck would I know that? Oh, I remember. Because there's this secret rule among business people where we follow people with 8 followers as a joke. It's like this fun thing that only I know about. I'm so glad that I was able to reveal that secret. Well, how the fuck? I don't know why he does anything. There's a lot of people out there. You got to talk to the director of the NFL today? What? Adrian, I just went back to real school and it's basically the same. What do you mean the same? Same as before? At least you're not on Zoom. Do you stream for recreation or is it a mixture of both? I know you love the subs. Do you actually enjoy it more than the subs? No, I only stream for subs. That's it. That's the only reason I stream. It's like, it's just a fucking ticking talk until the next prime. Yeah, just the flex on stands, actually. Yeah, no, I don't. None of my Twitch money goes to me. I have made $0 off of Twitch thus far. I am taking a cut of the YouTube. Though I have not yet to pay the taxes, so we'll see if I make any profit yet. Twitch money all goes to editors. I stream, at least originally, I streamed because quarantine was boring as fuck. I would work at NVIDIA during the day, and then at night I would just sit around. And I'm like, all right, what the fuck am I doing? And then I was like, well, I could stream. Because, you know, I would hang out with, like, Lud and Stans. And he would ask us to stream our POVs, like when we did Photoshop battles or monkey ball races, so he could use it for his YouTube video. That's the only reason I ever had a stream, was really just to do that. I had one. I mean, I had a partnered account because I worked at Twitch, but I never earned it. Like, I never did anything. And then quarantine started, and I was like, all right, well, I'm bored as fuck, so I'm going to try and stream every day for 30 days. Some people are still here from the 30-day challenge, which is like in May of last year. I was like, yeah, I'm going to do 30 days. And then after that, I basically just had so much fun. I played Undertale, I think, for the first time. Bryce Awakens, thank you for the 8 months. Vank Squad, thank you for the Prime. Have I been fishing recently? No. Do I look like a person who's like a heavy fisherman? Don't you guys yep every question I ask? No, I don't. I got nothing wrong with fishing. I just don't fish. The one time I fished, I was like 8 years old, and my uncle took me out. What's like it's like a canoe. Yeah, it was a canoe, like a big metal canoe. And my uncle was like, all right, we're going to learn how to fish today. And I was excited. That's the thing, is I was fucking excited. I was like, really? I was like, oh shit, I'm going to learn how to fish? This is fucking awesome. And he's like, all right, we're going to go to Bass Pro Shop and get you a tackle box, your own tackle box. And you're going to get all your own stuff to pick for the baits and the lures. And I was like, this is fucking awesome. So we went to Bass Pro Shop and I picked out this slick tackle box with these shiny lures and all this stuff. And I was like, all right, I'm ready. And then then we got to the canoe. He steps in. He's like, all right, get in. I just jump in. We move like 1 foot and the canoe flips. Like, it flipped instantly. And everything in the canoe went down the river, including my brand new tackle box. I was soaked head to toe. The day was ruined. I didn't have a towel or anything. The water was frigid. It was miserable. Yeah, so I just never wanted to fish again. That was it. My uncle, like a week later, was like, yeah, we try fishing again. I was like, nah, I don't. I never went again. Was it because you jumped? I don't remember. I should ask him. Maybe he'll have a better memory of it. Your username used to be Ontristing? That's sad, Phineas J. I like your new one. Big A, what you guys do? Rocket League, it's too easy. The reason I don't like Rocket League is because it's too fucking easy. It's like, you pick it up and you're instantly already mastering it. It feels like I fucking, 5 seconds on the sticks, I'm learning all the skills. That's the reason I don't like it. I wish it had a bit more depth to it, a bit more challenge. But you guys know how it is. It's like when you're built differently, it's just, games aren't a challenge to you anymore, I guess. I'm back from grinding Rocket League yesterday, and I'm shittier. Let me tell you, this is facts. This is actual facts. Write this down, Peepo G. If you are working on a skill, could be League, could be Rocket League, could be CSGO, could be Cookie, could be whatever. If you're working on a skill, and you're actually practicing, like you know you're putting in time to grind it, but you find yourself getting worse. A good example is like a Melee player might start learning how to shield drop or something and notice that their tournament results are getting worse. Okay? If you notice it's getting worse, that is a good sign. That is a very good sign. People always get discouraged. If you see your standard results getting worse and you're practicing, that's the key thing. That means you are absorbing new skills you didn't have before. And it takes a little bit for them to be incorporated into your play or into your real life or whatever. If you're noticing a deviation down, that is a good sign. You should be encouraged. Usually it's slingshots. The general idea is if you see it getting worse, you're slingshotting. You'll see it all. It happens in Melee a lot, so you can just notice it from that. People like, they try to, they've been doing things the same way for a long time and they're comfortable with that way. And they get steady results. And they're like, all right, fuck it. I'm going to try and actually get better. So they grind. And they're learning all these new things. So their performance dips from what it used to be. Because you're not doing the same old shit that you're used to. You're not comfortable with it. But once you incorporate that and you get it mastered, you start rocketing. So, yeah, that's just that. I mean, that's just light. I can see people sometimes get discouraged when I know they're practicing. And I'm like, bro, just give it time. Trust the process. Itrick, are you a smart fella or a fart smella? Another good question. I can have another great. I just love that we are getting nonstop good questions. A bit of both, by the way, is the answer. Yeah, I'm a bit of both. I'm not gonna not smell them. You can't avoid it. Yeah, someone said play a new opening in chess. A great example, yeah. If you're trying to like expand your openings in chess, you can play the same one you've always done and get the same results, or you can try to expand it. You're going to lose a little bit more at first, but then, you know, you guys get it. Itrick, why does Twitch have mobile delay? Because when I worked there, on my last day, I was like, fuck this. I'm going to do a little prank. I like to do a bit of trolling, so I snuck down to the servers on the basement level, and I went to the mobile one. And I just ripped some wires out on my last day. And I like flipped them around and like flipped them up. And I was like, and then I took a sticky note and I drew a little troll face on it and put it on there. And I guess they just never fixed it. That's just, you know, just like a little fun. Just a fun little thing. Yep. Just a fun little trolling I did to make all mobile viewers have big delay. Just a classic. Big A, I refuse to plug my phone in if it's not below 5%. Any tips? I got a real obvious tip for you, but I feel like you might not want to hear it. I got like a, I think a really helpful and a really obvious tip, but I just feel like maybe you're looking for something different. All right, chat, we're going to get into Targeting Tuesday here in a second. I'm sorry. I just got a prime from M2N who said, "Hey, Shrock, thanks for the Fizz guide you showed me the other day. Using it, I was able to go from Silver 3 to Iron 2, which is, if you don't know League of Legends, significantly worse. Very thankful. Thank you for that. Very kind of you. Always love to meet a fan. Donut crazy thing for the prime. Today is Targeting Tuesday. Targeting Tuesday. Let me get the theme songs ready. Okay. Let's get it set up. Big A. King Delroy sent me a sheesh. I just noticed I got another email from King Delroy. He said, "What's happening? Sheesh." He like wrote it all out. King shit, dude. ILC, I've been defeated today. Thank God Targeting Tuesday is here to solve all my issues. Sorry to hear that you've been defeated today. I cannot promise you that Targeting Tuesday will solve all your issues, but I hope you enjoy it. I'll tell you what can solve all of your issues in life, and that is a refreshing, soulful song from an angel on earth. Today's Marketing Monday. Let's go into the wins and fails, boys, because I have a big topic today. Bars. That is the win of the week.
Patriot. With Patriot. Tune into Patriot. With Patriot. Like it, that's why you're here to see which one of these companies will be marked as tier. Yeah, you've been waiting all week long, it's time to tune in, and since you're listening right now, make sure to invite some friends.
Patriot.
You know what I need is a Targeting Tuesday version. Because of how often I have to push it. I gotta reach back out to Delroy. Hand him another check. Keep the primes coming, because I have to. That's another thing I use the prime money for. I use the money for editors and stupid jingles that I buy. That one's not stupid, but I've bought stupid jingles. I bought a jingle for something that I never use. I need to find it. I've bought some dumb stuff. Yo, Big A, Two Trains said 2 months of tier one. Accidentally fucked up software at work that controls electric substations today. I'm sorry, what? You fucked up people's electricity at work? And then you said, really needed this targeting Tuesday? Bro, you need to go back and do your job. People need their power, bro. You don't need to be watching Targeting Tuesday. Please don't. If people start calling saying, hey, the lights are out, don't say, I'm sorry, I'm busy, I gotta watch Targeting Tuesday. Is tomorrow Hitman, or is, yeah, it's probably tomorrow, unless we really do League hardcore, but I think we'll Adric, is it realistic for me to move to marketing from IT without expecting a huge salary dip? It really depends. You'll probably, just anytime you move fields, depending on how far you are in your career, you're going to get some kind of salary dip. Although everyone in marketing makes 8-9 figures guaranteed, so it's not much of a dip, brother. Okay? I mean, I guess you have to dip into your Lambo to drive down to the country club and then ride your yacht. I guess that, but that's basically it. It's marketing, baby. Speaking of money and marketing, let's watch the intro. Tag yourself. You might be wondering why all the money was on fire in the intro. Because today is the top five times companies lit billions of dollars on fire. The five worst buyouts in corporate history. Through painstaking research and incomprehensible effort by the part of the Marketing Monday research team, I have found the five worst times the bag was choked. The bag was lit on fire by companies buying, acquiring, merging with other companies. Okay. Fumble Rooskied the bag. Yes, you put it so eloquently. Yes, the top five times the bag was fumble Rooskied. Now, people are saying things like Quibi. No. Quibi was never acquired by anyone. That's not a fumble. I'm talking about, let me set the stage, all right? This is where, let me give you an example. So Google bought YouTube for a few billion dollars. I think it was like $3 or $5 billion. Maybe it was even $1 billion. Google bought YouTube. Nowadays, YouTube is worth like $50 to $100 billion on its own. It's massive, all right? So Google made a great acquisition. That was really smart. They spent a lot of money, but they made a lot more. Sometimes, though, we don't hear about these as often. Sometimes a company will buy a company for a lot of money and then realize, oh, fuck. We've made a mistake. We've goofed it, so to speak. Today, we're talking about those and some of the lessons that could be learned. Okay? Now, first, let me start with some honorable mentions so you get the gist. Okay? Let me start with some honorable mentions. Because I'm doing top five, but I got a bunch. I got a bunch from my... So, first up, I want to talk about... This one's bigger than you think, is what I'll say. It doesn't seem like it was huge, but it was. This is the 1993 acquisition of Snapple by Quaker Oats. Okay? The Snapple brand. Now you might be thinking, how much could that have cost? It's Snapple. Yeah, well, I thought so too, and then I looked into it. It turns out, in the late 80s, early 90s, Snapple really hit their stride. Okay, Snapple was selling like hotcakes all over the globe. Snapple was doing really well, and Quaker Oats had a plan to make them even bigger. Now, if you don't know this, Quaker Oats had also bought Gatorade about 10, 12 years before that. And if you know anything about Gatorade, it's fucking huge now. Okay? So they had done a lot of smart things to make Gatorade from a medium-sized drink company to a very big one. They had done this big, bold advertisements. They associate with big athletes. You know, let me give you an example right here. You know, this is a perfect late 80s ad. Let's just say Michael knows what he's doing. Gatorade, all right? So it's not that Quaker Oats didn't know how to market, okay? They did a good job with that. So they bought Snapple for $1.7 billion when Snapple was hot. Now, if you know, it's hard to see with the relative numbers, right? But $1.7 billion is... almost double what Twitch was bought for. This is for Snapple, okay? But they were so sure they were going to make a hit off this. By the way, at that time, Gatorade sales were only $1 billion. Gatorade was making about $1 billion. So, like, they bought it for $1.7 thinking they could go bigger than Gatorade. They were thinking they were going to make... fat stacks. All right. So that was the first problem. Okay. The second they buy them, they start, instead of going hands off and being like, all right, because Snapple, let me give you an example of a Snapple commercial from the time. I think I had a good one ready actually. Let me give you an example. Maybe this is good.
Hi, a kid in high school wrote to me.
This is perfect. So they had this thing called the Snapple Lady. This was Snapple's marketing. And they were doing this very, you know, you guys know Snapple, right? It's like kind of an indie. It's like Snapple is not Gatorade. Snapple's not a success drink. Snapple was trying to be indie, right?
From detention, I only.
Like, not like, like it's supposed to be like an alternative kind of drink. It's like, that's how they market it. They market it as something that's like quirky. Quirky. Quirky is the right word for their marketing. Quirky.
We have a Snapple iced tea to pass the time. Signed, Suddenly Caught Talking. Poor guy.
So they had these commercials with this. She was famous in the late 80s, early 90s. She was the Snapple Lady. And she would do this commercial where she answers letters from Snapple fans and they would do funny things for them.
I only have this a was Snapple their marketing. Iced tea to pass the time. Signed, Suddenly Caught Talking. Poor guy.
Excuse me, is Jeff here? Thanks for your letter, Jeff. Here's some iced tea to pass the time. But remember, nothing takes the place of a good education.
Grab some Snapple, man.
We didn't know he could write this well. Maybe we'll use some of that writing energy in his English classes.
Made from the best stuff on earth. You know, you guys get it. Listen, I'm not saying these ads were fantastic, but they were working. They were working. And people understood that Snapple was different from other, they're not like the other girls. Snapple was different from the other, not like the other drinks, okay? So it was working. It was quirky. It was different. It stood out. The second that Quaker Oats acquired them, they said, let's do this like Gatorade. Now, so they made an ad. I mean, they made a bunch. They had them for a few years. I'm going to try to find the example that I thought was really fucking. So they started spending way more on high production value ads. There it is.
Snapple has a dream. Not be the largest, most powerful drink maker in the world, or even the second largest, but to be the third largest.
Did I lose my camera? Wow, a classic fix-it situation. Wait, where'd my camera go? Bro. Oh. Hello. Hello. Okay, I'm back. Okay, so wait, let's watch this ad.
Has a dream. Not be the largest, most powerful drink maker.
You're already noticing a massive difference. They bought a parade. It's like a big production value ad. It's way different from what they were doing for all of their success.
In the world, or even the second largest, but to be the third largest, because to us, number freedom equals freedom. Freedom to do what you want us to be doing. Making the best stuff on earth.
Born free!
Snapple, made from the best stuff on earth.
Anyway. It was this whole stupid, we want to be number three ad campaign. It was bigger. It was in your face. And they paired it with the only thing they knew how to do. So Gatorade is really good about selling gigantic, like how many ounces is like a fucking, I'm trying to see if I have the example, but like 64 ounce, 32 ounce bottles. Okay. You know, Gatorade sells, and they sell them in pallets, too. Like, you could buy a lot of Gatorade, or you'll buy a big thing of Gatorade. And so, they went to grocery stores, and they started taking away the small individual-sized bottles of Snapple and forcing them to stock the 64 ounces, because there's better profit in that. Turns out, most people don't want to buy that much Snapple. They just want to buy one for lunch. They also went to all, like, the bodegas and the, like, small convenience stores, all of, like, the places you would buy a Snapple, and they stopped dealing with them, and they went to the big grocery chains and focused on that. Turns out people don't want to buy, like, 40 Snapples from Costco, or they just want one. And so it collapsed the brand. I mean, not only did it... Like, everyone that was buying it at lunch was not able to. They just stopped doing it. No one wanted to buy 64 ounces of Snapple. And the ads were, like, a huge shift in tone. So people were, like, turned away by the brand. You combine all that, and they collapsed Snapple in, like, 5 years. They went from, like, a gigantic growing drink company to basically collapsed. And they had to unload the company for about $300 million. So in a few years, they went from spending $1.7 billion... They just burned $1.4 billion in a few years. Now, that it was stupid enough to be on my top five list, but the money amount wasn't big enough. So I want to include him as honorable mention. She's like, if you study it, it was like they did everything wrong. They bought him and did everything wrong. And Snapple, it's now doing fine. I mean, it's its own company, I think, or it's been acquired by someone else. But they were not the good owners of Snapple. Fumbled, bumbled, and tumbled. Yes, indeed. Other great... honorable mention, bag fumblings. This one's not really a bag fumbling, just stupidity in purchase. Zoomers, try and feast your eyes on this. I don't think you could even imagine it. Fox News, News Corp, bought MySpace. That's who we want owning our social media. They bought MySpace right when it seemed like there was still a chance. You know, there was a time in the mid-2000s when it was still a battle. When you could go, MySpace or Facebook, who's going to win? And they bought MySpace when it seemed like they were starting to lose. They were like, we could turn this around. Spoiler alert, they didn't. They spent $500 million on MySpace and ended up selling it for $35 million. Basically, they just made Tom rich. Now you can go to Tom's Instagram. And just see him travel the fucking world, living the dream with Fox News' money. He hasn't done shit since, dude. He just literally travels the world. Yeah, I mean, he just sold it for way too much. It collapsed instantly, of course. They tried this thing with music and bands that was semi-successful, but then they fucked that up too and ended up doing nothing. Yeah, look at this guy's life, bro. It's every day he's traveling a different part of the world. He's just living off. I mean, yeah, it's a great, you know, it couldn't happen to nicer people over at Fox News. So they lost, you know, $470 million. But again, that number's not big enough to make my top five, but it was very hilarious. At one point, let me give you another doozy here. At one point, here it is. This is a great photo. I really nailed it with this photo. eBay bought Skype. Stans Raid! Hey, thank you for the Stans Raid. Stans, an avid user of both eBay and Skype to this day. He sells his bathwater on eBay and he confirms it's real over Skype. It's a big Stans pastime. Thank you for the raid, Stans. Thank you for the sub. Yes, at one point, now Skype, of course, is owned by Microsoft now, but at one point in the early 2000s, eBay purchased Skype thinking, this is real. The people at eBay thought, okay, how do we grow our business? You know what people will want to do? They'll want to video chat with the people they're buying stuff from. This is real. They thought they'd acquire Skype and make it part of the service to where you would call the person you were going to buy from. That was their big plan. And so they paid a lot of money. I think it was $2.7 billion. Let me confirm. Yeah, 2.6, I'm sorry. $2.6 billion for Skype on that plan. It was not a good plan. It was not a good plan. It turns out people don't want to do that. They just want to send an email. In fact, they don't really want to talk to people at all. They want to click a button and just have the thing delivered. They hate human interaction. But they didn't know that at the time. So that's $2.7 billion down the drain. They ended up unloading it for about $1.5 billion less than they bought it. And then Skype grew again, and Microsoft bought them down the road for like $8 billion. So Skype kept coming back. People kept buying it for some dumb reason. But eBay didn't make the money off that. eBay just lost money. They bought it, then sold it for less, and then someone else made money off it. So this was really dumb. This is one of the dumbest acquisitions, you know, of all time. But again, numbers not quite big enough. We got to get some really stupid numbers in the top five. Let me make sure... So this one was big enough, but I didn't think it was interesting enough, but I'll tell you, I'll just tell you about it. Do you guys even recognize these companies if you were born past 9/11? I don't even know if you recognize them, but so Sears and Kmart merged. you guys, maybe you've seen them. Actually, you have seen them. You've seen them like this. You probably, you can recognize it when you have this sign next to it, right? Now you guys get it? Now you guys know what I'm talking about? It's the store, Sears store. You probably thought it was one word. Sears store closing is the one brand, but it's actually two separate things. It's a company called Sears. Anyway, Sears and Kmart merged near their heights. They were both much bigger. Combined, they were the third largest retailer in the world, or at least in the United States, I think the world. And they combined and they thought they'd be superpowered. But the big lesson of the Sears-Kmart merger is that they were both starting to have troubles. And their solution to their troubles was to get bigger with someone else that has the same troubles. And this happens a lot in business where a company that is, you know, seeing systemic problems, like things that would become big problems later were just starting to show. The cracks were starting to show. Like Sears started to notice that mall attendance was starting to slip a little bit. Malls were less profitable. Online was starting to get bigger. This was early days of Amazon. They were like, wow, this could be a problem down the road. But if we acquire Kmart, this will never be a problem. We'll get so big and then we'll figure it out. But instead, what they did was just double their problems. Instead, they just had more employees and more stores that they couldn't afford. More malls they couldn't afford. And so they went for the too big to fail strategy and it did not work. They failed. And in 2018, Sears Kmart combined filed bankruptcy. So the entire amount was lost. A complete write down. One of the worst. Oh, yeah. Another funny part of this is that when Sears merged with Kmart, they spent so much money making the merger happen that they had to make like budget cuts on the actual stores, which made their, they had like fire employees and like reduce quality of service. And so right when they needed to like invest in like upgrading their online and like making the stores better was when they had wasted all their money on this merger. And so it actually like caused them to rapidly fail. Instead of a slow decline, it was like a rapid one. The stores became like ghost towns. So again, really, really fucked up the bag. Fumbled the bag, so to squeak. And I think that's my last honorable mention. So let's actually get into the top five. Let's get into the top five. I think, yeah. It's also worth mentioning, I'm sorry. I have to show one more. There's one more acquisition. There's one more. Just hold for 1 second. There's one more before I get into the top five. One more honorable mention that we'd be remiss to forget. And it is right here. Just gonna use one of my tweets from back in the day. Fuck, it's not loading. Ruin it refresh. Just a classic Atrioc tweet. Just a classic Atrioc tweet. just a classic tweet. Mixer was obviously, but I think for Microsoft, there was like a rounding error. It was like no money. Let's find out how much it cost. Actually, I don't know the value. It was bought when it was called Beam. I don't even think they fucking revealed how much they paid for it. It was probably nothing. But anyway, it had 0.2% growth. And obviously they spent a bunch of money trying to juice that with Ninja and Shroud, which didn't help. And it collapsed. But again, this is pretty small. This is small potatoes, but it is a terrible acquisition. I mean, it was pretty funny. It was funny because we used to joke about this at Twitch. So if you guys don't know, back in the day, Twitch had more of a delay than it does now. Twitch had a close to like a 7 to 10 second delay. Twitch's delay has gotten way down, but it used to be pretty bad. And Mixer didn't. Mixer was like really low, and that was their big selling point. They were like, we have almost instant, no delay. And if you looked into it, they were just doing the same thing that Twitch did when they were small, which is like use somebody else's servers. And if you have very low traffic, you can, it's very easy to have no delay. And so we knew that if they ever actually grew, they would have the exact same problems, but worse, because they didn't even invest in building their own servers. So it was just a funny situation where like their only selling point was like, if we don't grow, we're good. As like don't come watch us, but if you do, it's good. But not too much of you. So that was their big selling point, and it didn't work out. Not really effective. So RIP Mixer. Now we are done with the small fries. Okay, was enough with this chump change. You guys want to see a bag get fumbled? You want to see a lot of money get lit on fire by dumb corporations? Let's get to the top five, baby. Number five, Yahoo. Wait, let's actually make this bigger. Yahoo buys Tumblr. I put it in two ways. Yahoo buys Tumblr. Now, I thought long and hard about how I was going to explain the myriad of ways this was a dumb deal. And I thought, I should probably put it in a way that's relatable to my audience, okay? So I thought, what's a hot meme right now? Oh, those trade deals memes. So I sort of put it, let me make sure that I'm not leaking the next thing. I put it like this. Trade offer. You receive I receive $1.1 billion. You receive $3 million a few years later and a bunch of furry porn. And I hope that, does that sort of make the fundamentals of the business trade? This is basically, after my research, what happened. Marissa Mayer, CEO of Yahoo, basically spent $1.1 billion, $1.097 billion for a lot of furry porn. That's essentially it. at least if I could tell. So, yeah, Yahoo. Yahoo had a new CEO. Let's pull her up. Let's pull up Marissa Mayer. By the way, Marissa Mayer was in talks to buy Twitch at one point. You know what's crazy? This is after I watched Justin Kahn's video. This is Marissa Mayer, CEO of Yahoo. She was an ex-Google engineer that became CEO of Yahoo and immediately went on a spending spree, buying an absolute load of companies. The idea was to turn Yahoo around by buying new stuff. Big acquisitions. Again, it's pretty hard to fuck up the bag with Yahoo. If you guys don't know, Yahoo was a titan of the early internet. Yahoo was still one of the most trafficked sites, like, recently. Like, as well as late as, like, 2013, Yahoo was probably in the top 10. And, anyway, she was going to buy a lot of things. Actually, it was funny that, just a side story, she was going to be buy Twitch. Yahoo was, after Google got turned down, Yahoo was next in line to buy Twitch before Amazon. And the only reason the deal didn't happen, which is so funny now, but apparently the CEO and the executive management of Twitch met with her at her house, and she was talking about how the future of Twitch is going to be like not just gaming, but like music and chatting and all that stuff. And they were like, not sure about that one, queen, and like pulled the deal. And she was actually right. That's crazy that that's the reason that deal didn't happen. She was like spot on the money with that. What she was not spot on the money with was Tumblr. So the plan was for the SS Yahoo here to be pulled by Tumblr into the future. Tumblr was big with millennials, which at the time were what we called Zoomers. Millennials love this internet thing. They love memes. And Tumblr got it. And Yahoo wanted a piece of that. What she didn't understand was the sheer amount of porn on the website as well. A lot of porn. Not just the memes, but a lot of porn. So, when she bought the company for $1.1 billion, the plan that she enacted after a year was a revenue goal. She said, all right. Okay, first she said she was going to be hands-off. The first thing she said was, all right, Yahoo's going to be hands-off because we don't get it. We know you guys. You Tumblr, you guys are hip. We're going to be hands-off. But then about a year passed and they realized, all right, well, we did spend $1 billion and you're not making any money. Tumblr, we just realized you're not making any money. So now you have a – we're setting an ultimatum. You have to make $100 million this year. That was what – and apparently the truth is, well, from reading into it, that number was completely pulled out of her ass. There was no, like, math behind it. She was just like, all right, make $100 million this year. But she just demanded it. And so now the ad sales team at Tumblr is freaking out. They're like, how the fuck are we going to sell that many ads? And they start, like, desperately calling everybody and trying to sell the ads. And what they realize is most big companies that spend a lot of money on ads don't really want to be next to furry porn. It's just not what they're into. So, frantically, Tumblr banned all porn because they had to hit that goal. If you're wondering why Tumblr out of the blue banned porn, it's because they had to hit $100 million to make Marissa Mayer happy and couldn't do it without ideally banning porn. But all that did was drive the few people that were still using Tumblr off the website. I mean, without the porn, Tumblr was just old memes at that point because the rise of Snapchat and other companies at this time was now eating heavily in Tumblr's market share. So with a 1-2 punch, they just killed Tumblr. And by the way, they did not hit the revenue goal. And then Yahoo offloaded Tumblr for, I think, like $3 million. $3 million, dude. They offloaded Tumblr for like what Ludwig made during the subathon. They bought it for $1.1 billion and sold it for like Ludwig's sub count, bro. It literally nothing. It's a massive write down. That's and so I try to show it with this. Oh, sorry, wait. I try to show it with this. This is what $1.01 billion looks like. You know, just like this many stacks of money. This is what $3 million looks like. They just burned this money. That's it. They just burned. I mean, this money's just gone. The deal is off. So, that's that. My number five worst, Yahoo buying Tumblr. But as you may have seen from some of those leaks, that's not the last we may hear of Yahoo. Number four is a two-parter. Number four is a twofer. Let me make sure it's set up. Number four is a twofer. First, we had this. It's actually one of the great. Here it is. This is a perfect picture. This is actually, I was going to do a Photoshop. I don't need to. This picture sums it all up. So it's a two-parter, starting with Microsoft buying Nokia in 2012. Now, if you're wondering who these people are, that's the CEO of Nokia smiling because he just made a fuck ton of money for bad phones. And this is the CEO of Microsoft, Steve Ballmer, smiling because he's an idiot who would soon be replaced as CEO of Microsoft. But he did have that moment, famously. Anyway, it goes on for 3 minutes, but you get the idea. He was a big, sweaty, loud, yelling man who had gotten obscenely rich as Microsoft grew in the 90s and essentially ran it into the nowhere. It didn't go down, it didn't go up, it just stayed still for like 10 years. And then they got a new CEO, and now Microsoft's worth like $1 trillion. So turns out he was kind of holding them back. But he brilliantly in 2012 realized, hey, you know this iPhone thing that came out 5 years ago? It's doing pretty well. We should get in on that. So 5 years after the iPhone, they decided to make their own. They thought, okay, we have to get into that game. Mobile's getting kind of big. And so acting with the speed that you can tell this man has, they bought Nokia. They bought Nokia in 2013 for $7 billion. Okay? And they made, famously, the Windows Phone. Let's pull one of those up. What a gorgeous piece of tech. The Nokia Windows Phone. Can you guys even remember what life was like before our Windows phones? Like every day when I wake up and check my Windows Phone and listen to my Zune, I think, I can't even imagine a world where we don't have this game-changing tech. Anyway, turns out this did not light the world on fire. Kind of flopped. Similar to, actually, pretty much every company, tech company that wasn't Apple tried to do phones. Like Amazon did the Fire Phone, it flopped. Windows Phone. And then, not to be outdone, okay? Because this flopped. Oh, let me just make sure. I shouldn't forget to mention this. It's in my notes. just so we don't forget, Nokia offices. Sorry. Microsoft acquired all these buildings, right? I mean, when they got them. By the end of it, in 2015, this is 2 years later, only 2 years after owning the company that had lasted forever, they fired 15,000 employees. And they wrote off a $7.6 billion loss. Now, they only paid $7 billion to buy it. So They bought it and then had to write off $7.6 billion more. So pretty much an absolute life-altering fuck-up. Like 15,000 fired, money lost left and right, no phone sold, Nokia brand collapsed. All because they thought they could compete with the iPhone. Kind of cringe. And it was a major point, I think, in what led to Ballmer being, you know, kind of sunsetted out of Microsoft and getting a new CEO. Because he'd been the CEO for a long time. Pretty cringe. But Google said, you know, let's not get outdone here. Okay? Let's not get outdone here. We can spend a lot of money on phones, too. So famously, this is all part of number four. Google bought Motorola. This is the greatest photo I have. Google bought Motorola. And they said, all right, $7 billion for a phone company. That's chump change. All right, let's do you one bigger. Let's go 12 and a half. So they bought Motorola for 12 and a half, thinking, all right, now that's going to fuck over the iPhone. And and they did really good on the OS, right? I mean, Android was amazing. So they had that down. But the problem was Motorola couldn't make good phones. This might not even be Google's fault. I don't know. I'd have to research it more to figure out where it went wrong. But let me tell you, Motorola could not make a quality phone to compete in the modern smartphone era. And so by 2014, which was only 2 years after they bought them, Google thought that the phones they were making were so ugly and poorly constructed that while they still owned Motorola, they went to Samsung and LG and begged them to make their phones for them. And that's where the Pixel came from. So like... Google literally like side-chicked Motorola after buying them for $12.5 billion. And in 2014, they sold them off, realizing it was a bad deal, for $2 billion. A little under three, so like $2.5 billion. So if you're doing the math, that's $10 billion lost in 2 years on a bunch of shitty phones that didn't sell. And that is why it is in my top four. What a stupid, stupid acquisition. Everybody that tried to get into the phone game didn't. Pixel's fine. No, Pixels are good. Pixels are not made by Motorola. Pixel was after they had the failures of Motorola to learn from, and they went with LG and Samsung. So the Motorola ones, though, trash. That's the number four. Again, all this led to was a lot of layoffs and wasted money. Let's go to number three, though. By the way, Amazon Fire Phone was equally as a failure, but the one thing Amazon did pretty well was not spend absurd amounts of money acquiring somebody. Amazon didn't go buy Sprint to start the Fire Phone. They just tried it, realized it failed, and moved on. It was easier. They didn't have to lay off people or anything. So, number three. All right, to understand number three, you have to watch this clip, okay? This clip will explain it all for you. I love this clip. This clip is number three of the worst acquisitions of all time.
So then it hits me. We can take this thing called the radio and put it on this new thing called the internet. And no one was doing it. No one. So we started hoovering up the deals. Eat this. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. Eat it. Eat it. Eat it. Don't chew. Just let it dissolve. Hold.
This is very hot.
Hold.
I just think physically I'm
holding
for it to dissolve in my mouth.
Now chew. Chew. Chew.
It's very hot. It's good. It's good.
Good. It's the fucking best. This whole place is. You call this place and they don't know you, they pretend they don't speak English. Mm. You see a single white face in here? No, you don't. Mm. Anyway, next thing you know, we IPO, stock triples in a day, and AOL gobbles us up. All of a sudden, I'm 22 years young, and I'm worth 1.2B. Now, a couple decades later, I'm worth 1.4. You do the math.
Okay. Well, that's a gain of 200 million over 20 years. 16.66 repeating. That's less than 1% return. Inflation is like 1.7. I think CDs are 2%.
So it's less than a CD.
Well, no one ever got laid putting money in the bank. Am I right?
So that's Mark Cuban to a T. That is literally the story of Mark Cuban. This is not... Because number three, Radio on the Internet, was Yahoo's acquisition. Of Broadcast.com. Mark Cuban's genius idea. Let's look at a young Mark Cuban. In the late 90s, at the height of the dot-com, when anything, you could say anything on the internet, you'd make a bunch of money. Mark Cuban invented Broadcast.com, Radio on the Internet. And sold it for a whopping. Now think, remember, Twitch is essentially the modern version of Broadcast.com, right? But with actual video. Twitch sold for about $1 billion, a little under $1 billion, okay? Broadcast.com in the 90s sold for $5.7 billion. Basically six times Twitch for... Radio on the Internet. Now, I want to get this stat down. I believe that, if I'm correct, let me make sure I am. I don't want to be wrong. I think they paid like $10,000 per user. Like, Broadcast.com didn't have that many active users. I think at the math, they literally could have like... They could have given people $1,000 to try Broadcast.com and it would have been a better use of money. I literally think it was just it was absolutely the most, like, the numbers are crazy, but also just the sheer foolishness of it. The sheer idiocy. So I actually included this image because I thought maybe Yahoo was my only two-time award winner on this. And I thought maybe Yahoo was trying to get a stupid acquisition for every logo. I was going to put dunce caps on all of them, but I figure you get the idea. By the way, this one doesn't need a dunce cap. It's actually just the worst logo I've ever seen in my entire life on its own. So, yeah. And Mark Cuban was not dumb in this. Mark Cuban was maybe a scammer, but he did not think that Radio on the Internet was smart, because the second he got his Yahoo stock, the second... He sold all of it that he could, and the stuff he couldn't sell, he made a bet. It's called a strangle in options, but he basically made a bet that it would go down. And so when it did go down, because he couldn't sell it, he made money off that. He basically knew instantly, and he used that to get $1 billion, join the Trace Commas Club, and buy the Dallas Mavericks, and he's never been out of our cultural consciousness ever since. But it wouldn't have happened. He was a former bartender. He wouldn't have made an out of $1 billion had Yahoo not drastically overpaid for Radio on the Internet. What a sale. What a sale. Yeah, it's the most expensive acquisition Yahoo's ever made. The service was quickly discontinued. I'm trying to see... Yeah, it was. I'm sorry. I'm just to confirm. It was $10,000 per user. They had about 500,000 users on Broadcast.com. 500,000 users for $5.7 billion is... It's just so stupid. So, it's been called one of the worst acquisitions of all time. And Mark Cuban has laughed all the way to the bank ever since. Mark Cuban is now personally worth more than Yahoo, the entire company that bought him all those years ago. His personal wealth outstrips that of the company. Tides do shift. Were they outbidding anyone? I don't even think so. There wasn't even a bidding war, bro. It was just like Yahoo's like, we can't. I don't even ask for one. We won't give it to you. We'll give you five. Okay? You deserve too much, King. Radio on the internet, that is genius. So they bought him up for $5.7 billion, making it the number three worst acquisition of all time. Number two. Now, I think you Zoomers might remember something that happened in about 2007, 2008. Maybe you remember. It was a big economic thing. Maybe you remember it. It involved houses. So right before that, like actually basically as it was happening, not even before it, but like as everyone was like, oh, fuck. This housing bubble's kind of bursting. Bank of America. Let's get the image here. Yeah, this image will do. This is actually a funny image. I'll just use this. Bank of America acquired Countrywide, which is a mortgage lending firm. Now, you could be forgiven for not knowing Countrywide banking and home loans. Again, what Zoomer or Millennial is ever going to buy a house? We wouldn't know what this is. But it's the largest mortgage lender in America. Okay? So they had lended a bunch of mortgages to people across the country at the height of the housing boom. And Bank of America said, holy shit, this mortgage business looks great. This looks fucking awesome. You guys are making money hand over fist. Let's buy you. So they bought Countrywide for $2 billion. And that seems cheap at the time. Everyone's like, wow, what a great deal. Why was Countrywide willing to sell for only $2 billion? They're making money hand over fist. $2 billion is nothing. This is a great deal. So now, again, for most of these acquisitions, like if you buy Tumblr, for $1.1 billion and Tumblr goes to zero, then what you've lost is $1.1 billion. That's terrible. But if you buy a company that lends people money, then you've also acquired their debt. So you can lose more than what you paid. So Bank of America bought Countrywide for $2.2 billion. And that's a lot of money, of course. But if they had just lost that, it would be like, ah, whatever, you know? Damn, we made a mistake. That was dumb. But they also acquired all of Countrywide's outstanding debt. And they found out instantly. Like, the second the deal was signed, the housing market started really collapsing. And they started realizing all of these mortgages were lended to people who can't pay them back. Which means that it's just a bunch of outstanding debt. And within a few months, I believe Bank of America had to pay $50 billion in outstanding debt on the Countrywide mortgages. Which means they spent $2 billion for the right to spend $50 billion. Which really is the dumbest fucking thing I've ever heard. I'm so shocked that we live in a world where this is not number one. I'm shocked and appalled that this is not number one. But there is a worse one. There is a worse one. But yes, spending $2 billion for the right to lose $50 billion... There's someone's been dumber than that. They did not do their due diligence at all. They had no idea what was coming, and they were wiped out. Total disaster, top to bottom. Countrywide, really stupid. But number one, now that, that takes the cake. The number one, drum roll please. worst merger acquisition of all time by a landslide took place. Let me set the stage. It took place again at the height of the dot-com bubble. let me black this out. I'm going to show you. Actually, we're going to black all this out. Yeah. This will be good. Okay. I'm going to show you a company. All right, let's black all this out too. A company. Wait.
Every day, America Online is making it easier
called
for people
America
to live,
Online.
Work, and play.
Hey, Dan, ready for the game? I'm just finishing up here with my new kayaking friends.
Kayaking friends on your computer?
Yeah, I just got America Online.
Sounds great. Listen, I can't go to the game today.
What?
I've got to send something for my mom's birthday. It's tomorrow. I'll then book plane tickets for our trip next week, and my kids got to go to the library to look up dinosaurs.
Hey, we can take care of all that before we go.
Yeah, right.
Oh, with America Online.
America Online can do all that?
Yeah. How about sending your mom some nice flowers? All you do is click on Marketplace. We place an order.
Call now for America Online.
Wow, the UI is crazy good.
To communicate, have fun, and get instant news and information.
Flowers are sent. Now let's access the online travel service.
How long have you had this?
About a week. And it's so easy. All you do is point and click.
But how does it work?
All you need is a computer and a regular phone line. They send you the software and give you 10 free hours to check it out.
10 free hours?
Call now for your free America Online.
So you might notice a couple things from this commercial of America Online at its peak. One, most importantly, they charged you by the hour. And it was slow. It was dial-up that charged you by the hour. That's a business model that could never go out of style. So let me show you their stock chart. This is it. 1992, the company goes public for $61 million. By 97, they're worth 4 billion. People love them. By 98, they're worth 19 billion. By 99, they're worth 105 billion. By 2000, they're worth $160 billion. One of the most valuable media companies on planet Earth. And at this point, in January of 2000, at this $160 billion market cap, which I'm sure will rise even more to the moon, like GameStop stock. At this point, they decided they wanted to go shopping. They wanted to take what they offered, their new media, the power of the internet, and merge it with old media. And they found a sucker. Let me show you this man. This man was the CEO of Time Warner Communications. Time Warner, one of the biggest media companies in American history. They lasted for decades. I mean, they were actually, I don't know how old was Time Warner. At the time of the acquisition, I think it was like the biggest cable company on Earth. It had like newspapers. I mean, it was a huge old media company, okay? And because of the magic of the internet and the magic of people getting way too excited about stocks, cough, GameStop, cough, Dogecoin, cough, Tesla, for some reason, AOL, which made about this much money, like, let's just put it in red. This is about what AOL actually made, was worth this much. And Time Warner, which made about this much money, was worth about the same amount. It was kind of worth what it made because it was an old media company. So people thought it wasn't going to grow. So Time Warner was, despite making about 10x what AOL did, it was worth about half. And so AOL was like, okay, we'll buy you. And Time Warner should have been like, fuck you. We make way more money than you. We should buy you. You're a scam. But instead, they said, oh, shit, really? We'd love to be part of the internet. We don't really get it. We'd love to do that. Let me show you. Let me show you some comments by their CEO. It really is a treat.
Guys, you know what? An old Steve K. only 45.
Here it is. So, in a remarkable instance of good journalism, this is CNBC back in the day. This is an old clip of them quizzing the CEO on why he would do this deal.
And company will come from your.
Give film.
80% of the cash flow of this combined company will come from your company, and yet your shareholders will own only 45%. Why were you willing to sign off on the deal?
Oh, well, pretty clearly, you know, if you looked at last Friday, the market cap of AOL was twice the size of Time Warner. I've made a judgment, which I believe to be correct, that going forward, the Time Warner shareholders will be much better off owning 45% of AOL Time Warner than 100% of Time Warner. Time Warner shareholders will be much better off owning 45% of AOL Time Warner than 100% of Time Warner.
Yeah, he was wrong. He was wrong. So instead of owning all of a big media company, he gave up over half of his company. They definitely knew. He didn't know because... If you want to know what he thinks about this, they actually interviewed. I found an interview with him years later. Someone tracked him down, Turner himself, the man who owned the most of the company that was sold to AOL. Let me get this. And he said, it's a really good quote, so I don't want to butcher it by going from memory. Wait, I gotta find it. Oh man, I have too many tabs. Where is it? It's right up. This, here it is. Okay. He said, I'd like to forget it. That's what goes, they asked me what goes through their mind when he thinks about what happened to Time Warner after AOL bought it. I'd like to forget it. That's what goes through my mind. I almost didn't do this interview because I didn't want to dig it up again. Let it pass into history. This should pass into history like the Vietnam War and the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. It's one of the biggest disasters that have occurred to our country. I lost 80% of my worth and subsequently lost my job. We looked it up to see if I was the biggest loser of all time because I lost about $8 billion personally. That guy in the clip earlier. The guy who so confidently said that owning... less than half of the new AOL company would be worth more to him and his employees than owning all of Time Warner Cable. So anyway, the team that owns Time Warner is like, you know, they're older, they're experienced journalists, they've been around for a while, they're an experienced media team. And suddenly their new bosses are a bunch of like internet hotshots that started AOL 4 years ago and don't really know anything. And they don't get along. So not only is the plan of like them working together to build the greatest media company fucking ripped from day one. AOL is based in California. Time Warner is based in New York. They hate talking to each other. They don't fucking get along at all. There's immediately hostility. But the second the deal completes, this happens. Let's pull it up and get rid of my black boxes. It goes from this to this. Because this thing called broadband comes out and people don't want to pay by the hour for America Online anymore. So all of this AOL stock, but by the way, this deal was done with stock. What that means is they bought Time Warner Cable with AOL stock. So everyone at Time Warner just got AOL stock. They didn't get money. So one of the biggest media companies on earth got bought out for worthless garbage. And so the next year, not only do they lose all that money, they have to do a write down of, drum roll please, $99 billion lost in a single quarter, the highest loss in business history. $99 billion write down almost immediately after acquiring, being acquired by AOL. It was a merger, but AOL did the acquiring. Everyone involved lost money. Tons of people were fired. It was a massive blow up, massive disaster. And both companies have been worse ever since. And I think they're now worth, I mean, nothing, but anyway, that's the end of the story, except for one thing. So because this was such a disaster, and because a lot of people, like, not just like, imagine like if Tesla stock collapsed tomorrow, there'd be a lot of people sad, right? People would be like, I lost money on Tesla stock. I'm so sad. And they're kind of angry. Like, how did I get duped? People were duped. People lost a lot of money on AOL, and they felt angry. And so there started to be a lot of journalists asking questions. And they were like, how did this happen? How did we all get so duped by AOL? What happened here? And I saw this. This was my... I saw this article from 2000. Announcing the merger. This is from 2000. Internet leader and entertainment firm going to join forces. New company worth $350 billion. AOL is going to be joining. And they got this quote from a guy from Bear Stearns. By the way, Bear Stearns, one of the companies that would go out of business years later in the housing market. But this guy, Scott Ahrens, said, together, they're an unprecedented powerhouse. If their mantra is content, this alliance is unbeatable. Now they have this great platform they can cross-fertilize with content. Just buzzwords. Just trash buzzwords. The kind of shit people say about Dogecoin and fucking Tesla today. This is the kind of shit you're today. But I was like, you know what? I'm kind of interested. Where is Scott Ahrens now? I saw this article. And I was like, you know, this guy was so fucking wrong. I wonder what he's doing now. So I Googled him. I did some little light e-stalking, and I found out. Well, he's currently a real estate agent. He's no longer involved in finance. He's been out of it. But a few years after this prediction, he had done an interview. With people asking, with PBS. PBS did an expose. They were asking, why the fuck did all these dot-com stocks crash? Like, how did everyone get so duped? And so they interviewed this guy, Scott Ahrens. And again, I found this randomly by Googling his name. Scott Ahrens. And they asked him what he did as an analyst for Wall Street and and why he lied so much about why. Because he said pets.com was going to the moon. He said the globe.com was going to the moon. He did all that stuff. And so they asked him, they looked at all of his history, because what analysts do, right, is they recommend to the public if you should buy or sell or hold a stock. And they looked at all of his recommendations. They realized over his entire career, he never ever said to sell. What the fuck's happening? The stream just ended, right? He's actually raiding me. Please don't raid me. The Ludwig 100,000 audience is not the right audience for me talking about. It's just not. And I appreciate if some people came over here. Okay, unofficial rate's fine. Yeah. Unofficial rate's fine. Welcome. We are doing the top five. Wait, let me just the top five times companies fumbled the bag. We're currently on number one. These are the worst acquisitions in history. And on number one, we are talking about this one right here. The rise and fall of AOL, where when it was at this level, it bought Time Warner Cable and then immediately went to this level. But anyway, so we're talking about this guy, Scott Ahrens. I want to show him real quick because it was just funny stalking his life. He made the worst prediction of all time that this AOL Time Warner deal would be amazing. and he told the public to buy. Okay? And they found out he never, ever, ever issued a sell. And PBS started calling him out on it. PBS was like, hey, what you're doing is corrupt. What you're doing is lying to the public and making them think stocks are only going to go up. And he said, no, people feel conned by the public. He said, right here, I found this line. They said, you never said you don't like a stock. You only said you liked it. You said, no, he said, that's not true at all. I said I didn't like stocks. Wait, where is it? All the time. And then they said, do you remember an example? And he said, yeah, I said it about Amazon. I was one of the first people to turn negative on Amazon. That was the one example in his whole career of pumping shitty internet stocks of a time he said you shouldn't buy. So I just want to close this Targeting Tuesday by saying I think I found the biggest idiot in Wall Street history. If you had just inversed every one of this guy's bets, you'd be a billionaire. Anyway, that's the end of Targeting Tuesday. The top five worst acquisitions of all time. Thank you for watching. Thank you for watching. He literally always misses. But just for a disclaimer, don't stalk this guy or harass his social or something. He's still a real person. He just made a lot of dumb decisions when he worked on Wall Street in the 90s and 2000s. Targeting Tuesday in the books. Say bye to YouTube. Bye, YouTube. Ludwig ended stream. Well, congrats to Mr. Wig on breaking the record. Ninja's crying. Ninja is crying. Oh, wait. Let me. Someone please call Ninja. But huge congrats to my dog. I guess I can tell a couple. We got a couple Ludwig people in here. Let me tell some early Ludwig stories. You know, I think that's what people want to hear. They want to hear about the times before he was filthy, stinking rich, out of touch, in a bubble. You know? Let's talk about those times. I mean, I've told this before, but I remember when I first met Ludwig, he was an editor for Scar and Toph. And I had only talked to him online and through the phone when I was hanging out with Scar and Toph. And I thought he was, based on his voice and his jokes, I thought he was really weird and I thought he would look ugly. I'm just telling the truth. I thought he was like, kind of like, I thought he was going to be really cringe. Just based purely off of his voice, because that's all I knew. It's toxic? Yeah. I mean, it's not like I didn't think I would, it's not like I wasn't going to be friends with him. It's just that I thought he looked way different. And then I met him in person and I was like, oh, this is not what I expected. And he was like really outgoing, you know? Just, I didn't expect him to be, I thought he'd be way more introverted just based on how he talked on the calls. And one thing I knew, because at the time he was incredibly broke, is he, I have to give him respect. And this is why we were friends kind of quickly. Is we were hanging out at a Melee tournament and I had Amazon money. Like Twitch had been acquired by Amazon and I had just started a job at NVIDIA, had a signing bonus. I had money, but he was 3 years younger than me and also had no income. And he was challenging me to $100 a match bet. Is Toph in the chat? What's up, Toph? Big T. So we would sit in a corner, like literally within like an hour of first meeting him in person, we were huddled in a corner of a venue at a Melee tournament playing $100 per game Fox Dittos, which is a really high amount to side bet, especially if you don't have the money. And like at one point he was down like $700 and I could tell he didn't have the money. So, like, I've told this story before, but that is the now knowing Ludwig now, I would revel in the chance to bankrupt him. But at the time, I was like just meeting him, and I was like, oh, okay, this I can tell that he's like starting to feel this. And so I threw some games to go back to like down 100. I still won. I still kept the money. But like I at the time I was like, okay, I just met this guy. He's like 3 years younger than me. I'm not going to. So I 100% I'll never ever again, never in our life would we ever throw a game to each other. But when I first met him, before I knew him, I threw games because I was like, okay, I'm not going to take $800 from this kid. That's that's crazy. So yeah, the first match fixing. Ever since we've tossed money back and forth, but that was the first thing. But the fact that he was willing to ride or die, that he was challenging me to the money, was impressive. He was truly a gambler. So that was I liked that about Ludwig off the bat. And then he was just generally funny. And then I started hanging out. We started watching his stream. This is back when he had like 30 to 100 viewers. But you could tell that he was funnier than, because I had worked at Twitch, right? And I'd seen people who grew and people who didn't. I knew from working there. And so I knew that Ludwig was going to be bigger than he was. Just because, I guess two reasons. Number one was that he was, I'll say his name. He, obviously he's funny, charismatic, all that stuff. But he also knew what stuff to yoink. Now, he said, now, the way he tells the story is that I said he'll never have more than 2K. That's absolutely false, obviously. Obviously, absolutely false. It's literally just never even true. It's because he set his goals at the beginning of the year, back when he was 300. He's like, yeah, I'm going to hit 2K this year. And I was like, all right, that's dope. I bet you will grow. But all I said was, bro, if you don't quit. I said you're good at this. If you don't hit 2K this year, don't quit. That's literally all I said. And he's like, he's turned that story into a fucking... No, I know I knew he would grow because I remember me and Stans used to flex a lot because me and Stans both had six-figure jobs and he had 300 viewers, right? So when we'd hang out, Stans would make jokes about the money difference. And I remember telling Stans in private, I was like, bro, because I know the math. I've worked at Twitch, right? I've seen people's revenue charts. I know how much Twitch streamers make. I knew it from looking at the back end. And I remember seeing that, like, the way money on Twitch works is not a straight line. Let me draw it for you. People think it's like this. Here, this is going to be a really beautiful drawing. Wait. People think it's like this. Like this is the money. Wow, it's really good. And this is the subs. Subs and like viewers. People think it's like this. Like as your viewers and subs go up, your money goes up. It is not like this. It is more like this. Let's use a red one. Go ahead. Like straight up to the moon, crashing through it. It's exponential. And so what I told Stans, I remember vividly telling Stans, I was like, bro, both of us make like 10x what Ludwig makes right now. I'm pretty sure very soon, not only will he make more than us, he'll make more than us combined. I remember saying that. And that was back when he had, like, no viewers. And that's not something you say about somebody that's going to be fucking 2K Andy, because 2K Andy doesn't make that money. I literally know that. I remember telling Seth, like, you better ease up on those jokes, bro, because the time is coming. The bottom is not subs. It's like viewers. It's like viewers, subs, just basically your channel size. Because once you hit this point, the money, you start getting way more money opportunities. The ad deals are bigger. The deals with Twitch are bigger. The sub count balloon. Like, it's literally just over here is where the real money is, right? Media share, donations, all of that. It's pretty flat here, and then it skyrockets. So, yeah, I remember saying that. And it happened. It happened really fairly quickly. I think You know, I don't know if he gives credit to Cutie, but he should. Because Ludwig is a 300 Andy for a long time. That's one of the reasons I was telling him not to be so rushed, because he stalled at 300 for a long time, relatively. Just for example, you know, I've been streaming for less than a year now. And, you know, I'm doing all right. And he had been streaming about this time and was still at 300. And so, anyway, I was just saying, when Cutie found his stream out of pure happenstance, Cutie was just, I think there's like a clip. If someone probably has a clip. Cutie found his stream. That was the spark. Now, again, it's one of those things where luck meets opportunity, right? Like, if you're, he's been hustling. He got better and better at streaming. He got good at bits. He got funnier. He got good at reacting to stuff. And then when the moment came along, which was Cutie farming e-boys and finding his stream, it was the spark. And from that moment, he never stopped growing, because he got a bunch of new viewers from that. Cutie just farming on his... Cutie was like a 1K Andy, 750 1K Andy. But like, they all liked Ludwig's stream when they saw it. And also, Cutie was connected to the Austin Show universe. And then they started seeing about Ludwig. And so... And then from there, he did the Pokemon thing. And from there, it was never stopped growing. But it was like a full year of being 300 Andy. Did you know Cutie before Ludwig and her were a thing? No, I met her through him. We met at TwitchCon. We all went out to Twitch. Ludwig stayed with me. My house is not far from where TwitchCon was held. And so Ludwig stayed at my place. And we went to TwitchCon together. And that's where he met Cutie in person for the first time. And we met her. Who raided you? Nobody. But Ludwig's stream ended, so I think people came here. But really, it was all the time me and him played Portal together for when he had 100 viewers. That's whenever people knew this guy's got what it takes. Or when we... When we did the 120-star Mario race where neither of us knew the stars. And so it took all Saturday. And there's no way any of you, I mean, maybe like five of you were there. He had no viewers at the time. But we tried to race it, but none of us had ever done it. Or I'd done it when I was seven. He'd never done it. And me having done it when I was seven was such an advantage that I took a break in the middle, got Uber Eats, stopped, ate it all live during a speedrun race on stream, and still beat him by like 30 stars. And it took me 8 hours. So you can imagine it wasn't the most rapid race. It was really quite the... It was really quite the race. I'm trying to see if we have any, you know, the Twitch tracker keeps, did I save any of these? Let me see if there's any, there might be some of these. Maybe it's here. No. Anyway, I mean, what is this? Sorry, man. I'm sorry for making you laugh so much that you're getting physically hurt. I don't know. That's the first monkey ball race. Anyway, yeah, it was an 8-hour race. But anyway, I know it's going to sound easy to say after the fact, but I've always thought Ludwig could be the number one streamer on Twitch. It's like, it's only because you have to look at other streamers on Twitch and you realize that he generally, it's like the competition wasn't that fierce. You know what I'm saying? Like, he works harder than most of them. Are lazy as fuck. Nowadays it's getting different, but when he first started growing, I was like, bro, most of the guys, like, you think, this is not knocking anyone, legit, but like, if you think about what the number one was like in 2018, 19, when Ludwig started getting big, not even ninja era. I'm just talking about like what counted as a bit, like someone like a Lyric, by the way, is super funny, but like someone like Lyric doesn't barely pay attention to his YouTube, for example, just as an example, or like Shroud would like not care about content or tweets or YouTube, or he would just be good at games. Right. So like the idea was most people that were big were just like someone who was really good at a game and got an audience that way, or someone who was kind of funny but didn't have any of the idea how to like build the YouTube, build the social, do recurring content. Like it was those two paths. And so he just worked harder than them. And he is lazy as fuck. So I hate talking about this because I feel like everyone is making the same points and I don't want to do it. It's like, it's easy to go be like, oh my God, Ludwig, what a hard worker. But you know him and you know he's fucking lazy. He's my friend. So I'm just going to tell it. But he just compared to the average Twitch streamer, he worked way harder, just way harder. And had better ideas and was not afraid to yoink. If you see something working, there's really nothing wrong with yoinking it. There's just nothing wrong with it. I mean, like, literally, like, people can shit on Instagram stories, but it worked. What are you going to do? Snapchat's crying. Someone call Snapchat, they're crying. Like, Instagram stories work. Sometimes you just got to yoink. So yeah, I mean, he made an absolute gargantuan amount of money. Did some money for charity, which was dope. I like that too. Again, the only thing about the subathon I didn't like was when he said he only made $3,000, which is a flagrant. It's a technical foul. It's a red card. It's ridiculous. Like if it had been anybody other than someone I know as a friend, I like Ludwig. He's my friend. I would never. If it had been like, I don't know. I'm trying to think of an example of someone who'd say that. If it had been like Tim the Tap Man or something, and he had done a subathon and had 200,000 subs, he was like, yeah, I'm going to make it 3,000. I would have had a, I would have like spammed Twitter, bro. I would have been, that's such a flagrant lie, but I assumed he was just like not thinking about it too much. But what I will say is that there's nothing wrong with if you have 100,000 viewers and 200,000 subs making money. There's nothing wrong with that. Listen, fucking Jeff Bezos makes way more than any streamer. That's the real problem, okay? The problem that actually, it's not a problem at all is what I'm saying. It's not a problem with making money. And I think other streamers in the same position would have been less generous. I think he did a good thing with the mods. I think he did a good thing with the charity. So really, I had no problem with it. The only thing I have a problem with was the saying only $3,000, which is absolute flawed. He's making hundreds of thousands of dollars, no cap. Hundreds of thousands, easily. There doesn't matter if you include taxes, mods, everything. It's $100,000. Hundreds of thousands. And it's going to end up being millions after the fucking brand deals and the, you know, it's a millionaire. So that's the only problem. But then, you know, the charity stuff was great. And then, and I just think other streamers that were in the same position probably would not have been. I think he's worried. I think it worries him. I think he only cared about the record and not really the money. So, updated tune for DNA. That makes more sense. Yeah. And then the thing that bothered me, another thing that bothered me was when people would say something like, I feel so bad for his health. Like oh my God, I'm so like, he looks so like, oh, how's he gonna be okay? This must be really killing him. And it's like, bro, the people that were saying that are the type of people that stay up till 4 a.m., have never exercised, you know, like watch anime till 4, bleary eyed. Like they were watching a man get great sleep and work out every day. And they were like, oh man, is he okay? It's like, bro, you're not okay. You worry about yourself. Why are you worried about him? He's making $1 million and he's getting great sleep. Like, you're literally watching him live a healthy lifestyle. And you are not. So that bothered me. That was the one thing I was like, bro, I just made me like, just because it's not his fault. It really isn't. Like, he's very upfront about, you know, all the stuff that you need to say, which is like, don't donate if you can't afford it. Capping gifted subs, all the stuff that you know, less, you know, someone more greedy could not say. But at the end of the day, at that scale, at that size, you can't help but like abuse people that just have a warped sense of what's going on, bro. There's just people that that don't have a good sense of what's going on. Listen, I know Ludwig. The number one thing from the beginning was the record. He cares about that stuff. He wants to be number one. That's his goal, and he hit it. I think that's the dopest thing, is that he hit the record. I think maybe he thought he couldn't hit it at the beginning, so he didn't say it, but like once it was an earshot, he was able to say it. Like he wanted the record, and he got it. He's now made his mark on Twitch history. He's like, that's going to be a hard-ass record to beat. That's like putting your face in the cement, like your hand in the cement. That's going up on the wall, dude. It's a tough one to beat. But for sure, once it became apparent that it was going to get a lot of subs, the record was on his mind, because that's the thing. He didn't say it was possible to 200K. That's only because, if you're at 170K, you don't want to say, let's get the Ninja record and then not get it. You don't want to say it and not get it. He only said it once he was sure he was going to get it. So when he said it at 200K, he was actually sure he was going to get it. What's crazier about Ninja's records? Ninja got 200K without gifted subs. I think Ludwig's is crazier than Ninja's because of where Twitch Prime was at Ninja's time, and also because I think Fortnite had a deal. There was like a free... Also, back then, you could sign up for a trial. You could do like a Twitch Prime trial. And then you could just sign up for it. And so I think Ludwig's is actually crazier, especially with capped gifties. It sucks though. No, it doesn't suck. I mean, literally don't feel sorry for anyone with this much money, but if Ludwig had been this big 2 years earlier, he would have made $100 million, you know, like Mixer or YouTube or Twitch would have paid him absurd money. But now the platform wars are sort of over. YouTube's not making big acquisitions. I mean, let's not rule it out, but Mixer's gone. And so Twitch is not paying that kind of money anymore. Twitch knows there's nowhere else you can really go. FB Gaming. Ludwig goes to FB Gaming for 100 mil. Do you think YouTube would take a YouTube deal or Ludwig? Listen, anyone would take a good enough deal. Let's just be clear about that. But we have no idea. We can't talk about it. He's going to be a VTuber and retire. That's a brilliant idea. Anyway, I can answer any more questions. Let me think about what else I could talk about. But I don't want to, I don't want to do too much Ludwig stuff. One of the big goals of my stream is to kind of do my own thing. So, as much as I love my boy, he's entered into a realm where I have to like kind of separate. Otherwise, I'm just going to get, stuff that other people in the universe have to deal with. To be fair, it's a big event. No, it's an awesome, literally, it's fucking awesome. It's really cool. It was what was cool was like, as much as people would say like on LSF or something that there was a lot of doubt, like, oh man, donate to Sleeping Streamer. He actually did so much to fill that amount of hours with content. Now that I am a part-time, I stream as a hobby in addition to NVIDIA. But I've noticed it's hard to even fill every day a few hours. Like, to come up with new ideas. He had a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff. Yeah, that's just a hard thing to do. And I think the stuff he did around IRL with the gym streams and the walk and the cooking streams, and the walk around the house, is like a sign of the future. I legit think that's where streaming is going. I think the demand from fans is insatiable. They want to be in all part of your lives. And so I think that, like, he talks about just yoinking the idea of a subathon, but really a lot of that stuff was innovations. I think if you look at, like, where streaming is going, I think that's actually, that's a big, I think he was way ahead of the curve with that. Now, I don't know if he's probably going to keep doing that kind of stuff. Maybe he'll do some of it, but I think you're going to see in the future, that's where some of the biggest streamers come out of, is like where you can just sort of live along with their lives with them. And you think about it, that's how Twitch started. That was Justin TV. Isn't that crazy? Twitch started with Justin TV, which was Justin Kahn streaming his life. But Justin Kahn wasn't very funny or interesting. So it wasn't. But now, Ludwig has shown how to do it. By the way, that's not really a roast on Justin. He's just like filling the skill set you need to be a 24/7 live streamer is different than what you need to be a good businessman. Justin Kahn is a good businessman who has a great YouTube. He is not a very good 24/7 live streamer. Is there an earthquake? It's just my mount on this camera is bad. Do you think VTubers are bigger than real streamers? No. But I do think they'll get huge. Absolutely. I think the top streamers will always, well, the very top, tippity top. But again, you think about it, Corpse and Dream are basically VTubers. Just to be clear, Corpse and Dream are basically VTubers, and they're huge. So it's not. You know, people just need something they can latch onto. They're like VTubers with less steps. Shindig's to the moon. Yeah, Shindig's gonna buy. Would you ever do a subathon? No, I would not do a subathon. Unless I could make money from it. Then I'd do it. Are these subathons profitable? No, I heard they don't make any money. I heard from Ludwig that after all that work, you only walk away with $3,000. So I was going to do a subathon, but I canceled it. Because, like, what? I'm going to work for 31 days and walk away with 3K? I already make 3K now with 4,000 subs. Well, I make more than that now with my current subs. Why would I get 200,000 subs if I only make $3,000? Doesn't make any sense. Oh, what did Point Crow say? I lost it. Point Crow, did you ever beat that thing earlier? I walked in a Point Crow stream earlier, bet Believe. He lost instantly, and I fucking walked out. Now I know how believers feel. I walked into Point Crow's chat. I said, let's fucking go. I'm putting it all on Believe. And I dumped everything I had on Believe. And literally within a minute, he's like, oh, Believers lost the house. And I was like, all right, fuck you. Hey, by the way, Believers, I'm doing the Hitman world record speedrun tomorrow. I'm so excited for it. I've been grinding for it. If you guys don't know the story, I was the first person on Earth to see that nobody had ever beaten all three Hitman games back to back to back. on master difficulty in only a suit. Basically the hardest thing you can do. All right. And so I did it in 3 hours and 32 minutes. I was the first in the world and I got the world record. And then the guy that approved my run, look at this, verified by Soldier Q, was like, I could do better. So 1 week later on fucking Google Stadia, he shaved like 3 hours off, bro. He's like the Hitman. Look at all these records. He's got like a million fucking Hitman records. And he had to take mine. So he beat me. So I was like, all right, well, I can't beat that. That's crazy. 42 minutes is fucking crazy. All three games in 42 minutes. That's fucking crazy. But then I laid up awake at night just thinking about my run. And like, wait a minute. I really do want to get that record. So I started grinding. You know I love the grind. And ever since then, I've been getting better and better. And now I really feel confident that I have the skills necessary to beat this man's run. I think I can do it. And if not, I'll get hella close. I mean, I'm going to cut at least like 2 hours, 45 minutes on my fucking run. It's going to be a massive PB. It's going to be the best PB fucking ever. I know that. I'm just so much better now than I was when I did this. So I'm going to make the run tomorrow. I'm going to wear my fucking clown suit. So anyway, that's the plan. I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna make it happen. I'm gonna try and get the record back. Didn't you say you weren't gonna grind the run? I did, because I thought it was impossible. I literally thought this guy's the Hitman GOAT. I'm not gonna beat him. But like, I'm actually pretty good at it. I think I love Hitman, and so it makes it easy for me to learn and grind. And I got way better. And I was like, wait a minute. Some of my times are actually better than his. And then I realized, wait a minute, I could do this. And so, you know, I'm going to start trying. And if I don't make it, I don't make it. But, I really think I could do it. So that's the plan for tomorrow. What else can I say? I think we're about wrapping today. I mean, that was a good Targeting Tuesday. As you guys know, I work for NVIDIA, and so this month is particularly busy, and I've been having to reduce stream hours because I'm working on a project, and it's fucking molding me. Now, stop speculating. Stop speculating. I can do a work stream. Wait, let me see here. What is today? It's wait, I found the I found this. Is this it?
Your ass is IP of Atrioc after the 70-star run.
Amen, brother.
Wait, I that's found the
that's really good.
I thought of that. I found the Mario 64. Me and Ludwig's race.
I wish I thought of that. That's very funny.
That's fucking good.
Cannon full, baby, to bring us back in the game.
Ah!
I forgot. So, the first use of Gambit was, you know how there's cannon-less in Mario 64 is the cannon-less trick. I invented the cannon full, where you just use the cannon. And I called it the Atrioc Gambit, and it was really one of my core techniques of speedrunning. Wait, let me see if there's other ones from this. Uh, By the way, the stream title was $100 blind 70-star race versus insanely old boomer. Ludwig is about like a few months from being the age I was when we played this. You know what I'm saying? So I'm very excited for all the Zoomers. I can't wait for the Zoomer streamers to just start fucking calling Ludwig the Boomer. Because he's already in the back half of his 20s, bro. What's this?
I think I'm short.
Those are the kind of clips that really rocked back then. Those are the kind of clips that really made the channel what it is today. I'm trying to find, man, there was such a funny clip. I distinctly remember this. Maybe this is it. Where he was, this could have been the 120 star. Maybe this wasn't even the 70 star. I think it was the 120. This is actually the wrong stream. Fuck. There, I remember it because he was on. Oh, here it is. Actually, wait, I found it. Wait, I actually found it. Yeah, where is it? It was on the Shifting Sands Lands. Shifting Stands Lands, as we called it. Fuck is it? Oh, it's not gonna be in here. A bummer.
I'm glad you guys liked it. Didn't think you had it in ya.
I'm pretty confident Les gonna die on this level because he always does. So
why would you say that? Why would you say it? It's just disrespectful to say it. It's like poor sportsmanship.
Did he die in that level?
I died the moment he said it.
He died so many times. Oh, you died the second I said it?
No, I can't find the clip, but there was one where he's collecting all 100 coins on Shifting Stands Land, and he gets 99 out of 100 coins. And then he has the triple jump with the wing cap, and he goes, Yahoo! Hits a wall, falls into the quicksand, gets sucked underground, and has to start all over. And he mauled, like, I don't think I've ever seen him mauled. He screams like a banshee. And that was peak content for me. I don't think it's gotten better than that. Yeah, I missed the old ring. Yeah, that's what it is. Oh, wait, boops. Anyway, boys, that's the end of the stream. I think I'm ripping and dipping. I hope you enjoyed your stay. Congratulations again to Ludwig. I'll see you tomorrow, hopefully, for the world record runs. Check them out. Let's pass the love on. Let's raid somebody. That's what it's all about. Let's raid Coney. Let's raid Coney, because I'm going to play with... Nah, I mean, Cutie, I'm sure, has a bazillion viewers. I'm sure... Cutie's doing amazing after the end of the... Let's raid Coney. He's only one sub away. Good night, boys. Have a great one.